Would you stand and sing with us, Friend of God?
Who am I that you are mindful of me? That you hear me when I call? Is it true that you are thinking of me? How you love me? It's amazing.
Glory, you have called me friend. Jesus we love. Thank you. You may be seated. And ushers, you may prepare for the offering. As you have probably noticed so far, the songs we are singing this morning are focused on a theme, and that is love. Seeing that it was Valentine's Day yesterday, and our hearts are all warmed up from feeling loved by our family and friends, we wanted to take this morning to relish the love that God has for us and that we have for Him. We wanted to create a space for you to dwell on the faithfulness of God in your life and for you to be able to take a moment to say back to God, I love you too. With that in mind, I invite any of you who feel led to join me in silent prayer for a moment at the steps to prepare our hearts, and then we will continue on in singing our worship. We come to you in thanksgiving, knowing that all we are and all we have is a gift from you. In faith and love, help us to do your will. We are listening, Lord God. Speak your words into the depths of our souls, that we may hear you clearly. We offer to you this day all the facets of our lives, whether it be at home, at work, or at school, to be patient, to be merciful, to be generous, to be holy. Give us the wisdom and insight to understand your will for us and the fervor to carry out our good intentions. We offer our gifts of time, talent, and possessions to you as a true act of faith, to reflect our love for you and our neighbor. Help us to reach out to others as you, our God, have reached out to us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
As our ushers pass the plates, follow along with me as I read from the writings of the Apostle Paul in 1 Corinthians chapter 13. Paul writes this, though I speak with the tongues of men and of angels, but have not love, I have become sounding brass or a clanging cymbal. And though I have the gift of prophecy and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and though I have all faith so that I could remove mountains, but have not love, I am nothing. And though I bestow all my goods to feed the poor, and though I give my body to be burned, but have not love, it profits me nothing. Love suffers long and is kind. Love does not envy. Love does not parade itself, is not puffed up, does not behave rudely, does not seek its own, is not provoked, thinks no evil, does not rejoice in iniquity, but rejoices in truth, bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never fails. But whether there are prophecies, they will fail. Whether there are tongues, they will cease. Whether there is knowledge, it will vanish away. For we know in part, and we prophesy in part. But when that which is perfect has come, then that which is in part will be done away. When I was a child, I spoke as a child. I understood as a child. I thought as a child. But when I became a man, I put away childish things. For now we see in a mirror dimly, but then face to face. Now I know in part, but then I shall know just as I also am known. And now abide faith, hope, love, these three, but the greatest of these is love.
Mm-hmm.
Says in Psalm 139, O Lord, you have searched me and known me. You know when I sit down and when I rise up. You discern my thoughts from afar. You search out my path and my lying down and are acquainted with all my ways. Even before a word is on my tongue, behold, O Lord, you know it all together. You hem me in behind and before and lay your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is high. I cannot attain it. For you formed my inward parts and knitted me together in my mother's womb. I praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Wonderful are your works, my soul knows it very well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was being made in secret, intricately woven in the depths of the earth. Your eyes saw my unformed substance. In your book were written, every one of them, the days that were formed for me, when as yet there was none of them. How precious to me are your thoughts. Oh God, how vast is the sum of them. If I would count them, they are more than the sand. I awake, and I am still with you. Those who are able, please stand with us.
Thank you.
Almighty God, we come before you, mere humans. Lord, we come before you in humility. And God, I ask that you would move in this place today, Lord, that you'd move in our hearts. God, you know what each of us as individuals need from you today. You know how you're growing each one of us, how you're molding us, what you're teaching us.
pray that as a group of people, we would come before you in your holiness and in your power and in your goodness, that we come before you and just lay our lives down. Lord, that you would move in the hearts of both young and old to follow you with a passionate commitment in a way that maybe we haven't even known before, haven't experienced before. I just ask that you do something for today. As I prayed so often and will continue to pray, I ask that you make our church family what you want us to do.
That we would do what you want us to do.
That in everything we do it how you want us to do. I know today, all over the globe, there are so many open bodies of believers meeting together. And you love everyone. But God, you have carved out Faith Baptist Church for a specific purpose for your glory. And what I ask that you would lead us into that community of faith and follow your word. And if there's anyone hurting today, anybody hurting, that you would give just a special touch of your love.
Nick, stay in just for a second, if you would. You know, I came to Faith Baptist with my sweet wife and children 23 years ago, and I became the senior pastor 15 years ago, and probably the wisest, the best decision I ever made was asking Nick and Courtney to join our staff. And Pastor Nick came as an assistant pastor, but he wanted to make it official today. Nick is now the associate pastor of Faith Baptist Church. Nick, this is a cake for your daughter. Congratulations. And I'm going to take 2 days week vacation every week from now on. It's an honor and a privilege to have Nick and Courtney and their sweet kid, one that's on the way. We'll be here soon. Looking forward to meeting little Maxwell. Also, for those of you who've been praying for Nancy Walton, I want to let you know that her testing and meeting with the doctor about the kidney transplant is March 26th. It's been postponed for a couple of weeks, and we would keep her in prayer. And also, those of you who came today to hear Rob Shank, he had to cancel. He got real sick, and we're hopefully going to have him in 2 weeks. If it's not 2 weeks, it'll be 3 weeks. But sometime in the next few weeks, we'll have Rob again. We'll let make sure that you know. He called on Friday night, let me know that he wasn't feeling well at all. And some things happened where he couldn't make the trip. And he extends his apologies to you. But at the same time, in a way, I'm relieved. Because I had an opportunity to preach today on a special day. Not just the fame of being loved, but because it's my son and his wife last Sunday with us. And that's not special in terms of rejoicing. It's just special in terms of what it marks to me as a father. My children have been the greatest gift in my life. Both David and Brooke have been my right and left arms. And then their spouses are such a gift from God to them and to me and to Colleen as mother and father. Bobby loves the Lord and loves David with all his heart. John is a man of character and strength. He loves the Lord and loves Brooke. And we have 4 kids now. But Bobby and David will be leaving for Los Angeles tomorrow. David wants to pursue a career in acting and to be a gospel witness in that field. It's been something that's on his heart for, well, since he was in middle school, maybe even grade school. And we're going to be sending him off in prayers and into the service. We'll let you know how you can come say goodbye to him. But that being said, it reminded me of this weekend being Valentine's weekend and saying all of our goodbyes and having all the parties of what it means to be a father and to love your children. And then my daughter explained to me what the music was going to be today. I thought, what a wonderful time just to bathe in the Father's love for us. And I'm a sentimental person, although many people don't think I am. And I'm a romantic and a hopeless romantic, and it began in kindergarten. I started off hard with both music and love. I had 2 girlfriends in kindergarten, and you can see why now. That was me in kindergarten, and I had 2 girlfriends at the same time, Sarah and Sonia. And the teacher allowed us to do the square dancing together, all three of us. So because of my love for these two girls, two songs came to my mind, and one of them was A Bicycle Built for Two by Alvin and the Chipmunks, and Polly Wally Doodle All the Day. And those two songs would bring tears to my eyes as I thought about Sarah and Sonia. And then heartache came, and Sonia moved to Hawaii, and my heart was broken. I loved the song Go Away, Little Girl from Steve Lawrence when I was in kindergarten, which also became a hit two other times when it was done by The Happenings and by Donny Osmond, and it got me both times it came up. I was a big fan of Puppy Love by Paul Anka, and once again, Donny Osmond brought that back home a few years later. That was in kindergarten. I was love struck. And the Sarah and the Sonia put me on a path. My girlfriends were Cheryl, and then Susan, and then Suzanne, and then Shirley, and then another Susan. I've had a thing with Esther for quite a while, but I got over that. Then in first grade, the song by Leslie Gore, It's My Party, and I'll Cry If I Want To. I sang that, and when the car was closed and the windows were up, I would sing that, and then my broken heart from whatever girl just broke my heart in first grade. Second grade came Leader of the Pack, which was a heartbreaking ballad of deep love, and I fell in love with my teacher. Her name was Miss Hodges. Halfway through the year, she became Mrs. Dye. My heart broke, and all I could say was, sang along with Peter and Gordon, I don't care what you say, I won't stay in a world without love. And I sang that song all through second grade. Then third grade came, and Peter Davis recorded and performed Don't They Know It's the End of the World Because You Don't Love Me Anymore. So my love life was taken on a very sour tone by the time I was in third grade. Then fourth grade came, and a song by the Seekers called Red Rubber Ball. And it's about a young man recovering from heartache and sorrow. And the morning sun is rising like a red rubber ball. And that song, for some reason, stuck in my mind. And I loved that song for years. And of course, I was raised on Beatles music. I was a Christian from the time I was born until I was 13, which is the 60s, pretty much. And I was I embraced the Beatles and the Monkees and the Bogues and the Letterman and all those love songs. And the Beatles came on TV in the first globally broadcast television program ever, watched by 400 million people in 25 countries, and they sang the song, All You Need Is Love. And it set a tone, but they were hoping a message to the world that we need to love each other more than we have in the past. But then sixth grade came, and the Monkees came out with Valerie, and then a song that you'll recognize is called Little Arrow by Leafy Lee. My favorite song in sixth grade, these were the words. There's a boy, a little boy, shooting arrows in the blue, and he's aiming them at someone, but the question is it who? Is it me or is it you? It's hard to tell until you're hit. But you'll know it when they hit you because it hurts a little bit. Here they come pouring out of the blue, little arrows for me and for you. You're falling in love again and falling in love again. Little arrows in your clothing, little arrows in your hair. When you're in love, you'll find those little arrows everywhere. Little arrows that will hit you once and hit you once again. Little arrows that hit everybody every now and then. And then the kicker. Oh, whoa, whoa, that was my life. Love born, heartbroken, and then seventh grade came and things got really serious. Faces of Love by the Classic Four. Give Me Just a Little More Time by the Chairman of the Board. And then Love Grows Where My Rosemary Goes by Edison Lighthouse. That was when I was in love with Susan Orr. But then I became a believer in 1970. And I fell in love with a pastor's daughter. Her name was Shirley. And I was so in love with her, it could best be described in the words of David Cassidy from the Partridge Family. And when she said, this morning, I woke up with a feeling. I didn't know how to deal with. And so I just decided to myself. I hid it to myself and never talk about it. And did not go and shout it when you walked into the room. I think I love you. I was a deeply intensely romantic little kid. I got saved. After I got saved, there were these two songs throughout that entire time when I was just a regular American teenager growing up in Oklahoma, middle America, the 1960s, and that big revolutionary culture of change that was taking place, there were two songs that both hit number one. And they jumped out to me, but I did not know why until after I got saved. And the first one was Amazing Grace by Judy Collins. And the second one was Oh Happy Day by the Edwin Hawkins Band. I didn't know why those two songs meant so much to me, but I sang them all the time. And they lifted up my spirit. And it's because they sang about something greater than romantic love, something greater than sweethearts. Not just about love, but about God's love. And there's a song, I'm not going to sing to you, but I want to read to you the words. It was written first in the year 1050 by a German Jewish prisoner. And he was, and not necessarily a prisoner, but he was in an insane asylum. And he wrote a stanza. When he died, when they took him out of the room to bury him, they saw this stanza on the wall, and it was written down and circulated as a poem until the year 1917, when Frederick Lehmann found it. And he added some verses to it. And this is the song. The love of God is greater far than tongue or pen can ever tell. It goes beyond the highest star and reaches to the lowest hell. The guilty pair bowed down with care. God gave his son to win. His erring child he reconciled and pardoned by his death. And this next stanza was written by the Jewish German writer 900 years earlier. Could we with ink the ocean fill, and were the skies of parchment made, were every stalk on earth a quill, and every man a scribe by trade, to write the love of God above would drain the ocean dry, nor could the scroll contain the whole, though stretched from sky to sky. There's so much in the Christian life that fascinates us or captures our attention or sometimes becomes a burden and an obligation and a pressure of a life that makes us feel like we don't measure up, we don't matter, we're not significant, we've been set aside, or we have failed so miserably, God doesn't really take note of us anymore. I think it's important that on this weekend especially, let's focus on how much the Father loves us. And I say that because I learned a lot about love through the years, romantic love and having sweethearts all through grade school, junior high school, until I met Colleen in college. And I know that feeling, that exhilaration of romantic love. But there are other aspects of love. There's the love you have for your siblings. There's the love you have for your parents. Then there's this life-altering love that parents have for their children. That both Colleen and I experienced when Brooke was born and when David was born. I love that you can't really quantify and you can't really measure it. It's a different kind of love, and it's so naturally unconditional, you can't even hold it back. When your children fail, you love them. When they disobey, you love them. When they aren't what they're supposed to be, you love them. When they are what they're supposed to be, you still love them. It's a love that just comes out of you and you can't contain it. And as I'm thinking of David and Bobby leaving tomorrow, I'm reminded of my love as a father for them, as my wife's love for them as a mother. We've been blessed and fortunate to have two children who never really caused us one day of heartache. They never were disobedient. They never were defiant. They were always compliant and nurturing and supportive. We've had the wonderful privilege of having a great, loving family. But even if they would have, if they would have ever disobeyed or done something they thought would displease me, I would have loved them anyway. And so would have my wife. Well, if that's true of me, if I'm capable of that love, how much more is God capable of that love? And not just capable, he actually does it. Every single day, he loves me even when I fail. He loves me when I'm weak. He loves me when I drift. He loves me when I choose to rebel. He has loved me in every phase of my life. And today, there are times in life when you might feel forgotten. There are times in life when you might feel as if all that you contribute to the world is no longer available. You're just biding time. God still loves you. I want you to read out loud some verses with me, if you don't mind. They'll be on the screen. I'd like you to read them with me in unison together as a reminder to ourselves of God's love before we look at Luke 15. John, 1 John 4, verse 16. And we have known and believed the love that God has for us. God is love. And he who abides in love abides in God, and God in him. We may have boldness in the day of judgment, because as he is, so are we in this world. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear, because fear involves torment. But he who fears has not been made perfect in love. We love him because he first loved us. 1 John 3:1. Behold, what manner of love the Father has bestowed upon us, that we should be called children of God. Ephesians 2:4-5. God, who was rich in mercy, because of his great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. Romans 8:35-39. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or peril, or sword? In all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other created thing shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Romans 5:8. God demonstrates his own love toward us, and that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. John 3:16. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. 1 John 4:10. And this is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the propitiation for our sins. In Romans 5:5, the love of God has been poured out in our hearts by the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. With those verses in mind, turn to Luke chapter 15, and I want to briefly discuss the story of the prodigal son. As you're turning there, I hope you're reminded today that God loves you. He loves you as a father, and you can say he loves you as a mother. As a parent, he loves you with an all-embracing love, an accepting love, a comforting love, a provisional love, a protective love, a nurturing love. It is persistent. It is consistent. It never stops. It never gets weak. It never gets dark. He is always there. He will always love us. And sometimes we forget that when it comes to the Christian life. We get so performance-based and opportunity-based and task-oriented that we forget to be fed by the love of God. But if God doesn't love us, where is the meaning in Christianity? He loved us, therefore he sent his Son to die for us. God's love did not excuse our sins. God's love is the motive behind God reconciling our sins. He loves us. And every time I think of David and Brooke and Bobby and Josh, I'm reminded of God's love for me because of how I love them. When I watch my wife and hear my wife discuss her love for her children, I'm reminded of God's love for me. I don't understand it. I can't rationalize it. But I accept it. That for some reason that I don't quite get, God loves me. He loves me on my good days and on my bad days. He loves me when I'm not necessarily loving him in return. God loves you. There are many times in life when the love of a relationship is all that gets you through a day. You're facing hardship, disappointment, sadness, and it's knowing that somebody loves you helps you get back up and keep going. Or knowing that you love somebody energizes you and helps you move forward. There's probably no greater poverty in life than to not know that you're loved or to not love. And there are some of you who might feel like you're in that dynamic in terms of humans. Maybe there is no person you can name who loves you. Maybe there's no person you can identify that you know that you really love them. And it's a reciprocal relationship. that that is, at the very best, faith that is not your identity. You are loved by God. You are loved by God as a father loves his children. He wants the best. He brings in the best that he can possibly do. And he loves at all times. Well, Luke 15, we have a story. And it's one of three stories. The three stories all communicate the Father's love. He uses the stories to emphasize the level of rejoicing of the Father and the rejoicing in heaven when a sinner comes to trust in Jesus Christ as their Savior. The three stories, they escalate in the degree of devotion. The first story is 1 out of 100. The second story is 1 out of 10. And the third story is 1 out of 2. And they also escalate in the value of the object loved. And the first story is one of the sheep, one of the parts of your living. The second is 1 of 10 coins of a dowry that was essential to the wife's security. And the third one is 1 out of 2 sons. And in each story, the object gets lost, but for different reasons. In the first story, the sheep gets lost out of being confused and ignorant. The coin is lost out of it's indifferent, and it is inevitable to be lost. But the son gets lost because of selfishness and rebellion. And Jesus tells these three stories one after the other. And in each one of these stories, there's a challenge that the one who finds the object again says. The one with the sheep says, "Rejoice with me, for I have found my sheep which was lost." The wife who has lost one of the coins of her dowry says, "Rejoice with me, for I have found the peace which I lost." And the father, when he is able to embrace the son again, says, "Let us eat and be merry, for this my son was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found." That brings us to verse 11 of Luke 15, the story of the prodigal son. Then he said, "A certain man had 2 sons, and the younger of them said to his father, 'Father, give me the portion of goods that falls to me.' So he divided them to his livelihood. And not many days after, the younger son gathered all together, journeyed to a far country, and there wasted his possessions with prodigal living. But when he had spent all, there arose a severe famine in the land, and he began to be in want. Then he went and joined himself to a citizen of that country. And he sent him into his fields to feed swine. And he would gladly have filled his stomach with the pods that the swine ate, and no one gave him anything. But when he came to himself, he said, 'How many of my father's hired servants have bread enough and to spare? And I perish with hunger. I will arise and go to my father, and will say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired servants.' And he arose and he came to his father. But when he was still a great way off, his father saw him and had compassion and ran and fell on his neck and kissed him. And the son said, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and in your sight, and am no longer worthy to be called your son.' But the father said to his servants, 'Bring out the best robe and put it on him, and put a ring on his hand and sandals on his feet, and bring the fatted calf here and kill it, and let us eat and be merry. But this my son was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found.' And they began to be merry." Now, there is so much in this story, we have to really dedicate an entire message to it, maybe even a series, to draw all the richness out of the story. I just want to focus on one. And it's the father's love for this son. It's an amazing fact because even in this day, the son's sin against the father was an egregious violation of cultural practice, of religious practice. It would have been forbidden in any one of the religions of the day or cultures of the day. It was a terrible thing the son had done. He basically said to his father, "I wish you were dead so I could have my inheritance. But since you're still alive, give it to me now. I want that more than I want you." And he took the inheritance, and he left, and he squandered it all. But when he returns with his speech already rehearsed and ready to present to his father, maybe thinking he might have to convince his dad, the father sees him afar off. This tells you something about the father. The father never forgot his son as the son was off drifting around. The father never cut him off emotionally because the son had cut him off emotionally. The father still loved and still longed and still looked. And the father was ready when the son was ready. While the son was still afar off, the father sought him. And in the ancient culture, elderly, wise, patriarch men did not love. It was undignified. He lifted up the skirt of his robe and he ran out to his son. His son should have been the one running to him, but his son could have been so exhausted by this point that he couldn't. So the father, losing all sense of pride and all sense of position and authority, just simply, the son I love is coming back, and he runs out there, and before the son can say anything, the father throws his arms around him, hugs him, and kisses him. Already, it wouldn't matter what the son said next. The father was going to say, get a robe and get a ring and kill a calf. We're going to have a party. It didn't matter what the son said because the father had already decided it. The father decided it when he let the son leave. The father loved his son. Well, I know the story is given in Scripture to remind us of God's love, but it's also a conviction to those of us who ever spent any time drifting from God. No matter how far we drift, we have never gone outside the scope of God's love. How humbling that is. How nurturing it is. If it doesn't make your faith go deep into the soil that God loves you on your very worst day, God loves you throughout your worst year, God loves you through that whole phase of your life where you didn't give him two thoughts other than maybe to show up in church once in a while. God loved you through all of that. God loved me when I was in kindergarten. God loved me when I was in third grade. God loved me when I was in sixth grade. When I wondered, what was this Oh Happy Day about? But I couldn't stop singing. When I heard Amazing Grace, I thought, what a beautiful song. And I would sing it, having no idea what this Amazing Grace was. But 2 years later, right before eighth grade, I trusted in Jesus Christ as my Savior, and it all made sense. But God's love was constant. Since that time in 1970, when I trusted Jesus, God's love has continued to be constant. However many years I live after this, God's love will continue to be constant. The amazing thing is that God loves his own son, Jesus, to the same infinite degree, but in a greater unity because he's part of the Godhead, and God sent him to die for me. You know, often we get our sense of well-being, and the term is often self-esteem, and we get our self-esteem and the way we feel about the day and ourselves by what other people think of us. And I would caution you not to do that because it's very unreliable, it's very inconsistent, and the slightest thing can change somebody's opinion about you, even change their affections for you. That's not the best way to feel good about who you are and what you are. It's to see yourself in God's plan. As a father, he loves you. He loves you just as you are. He loves you for what he wants you to be, and he loves you for how far you've fallen short of that. But his love doesn't excuse our sin. His love doesn't excuse our failings. His love prompts from us a desire to obey. Tonight we're discussing one of the questions in the New City Catechism, what does God require of us? And God requires of us the same thing that I required of my children as a father, the same thing that Colleen required of them as a mother. He wanted them to obey and to love each other. We assumed that they would love us. Maybe it was a huge assumption to make, but we sort of assumed it. Our challenge was they need to be obedient and need to love one another. Well, thank God they did. And they returned the love to us. But our requirement, our greatest joy, was to see our children loving each other and being obedient. It was early in life when we began to practice allowing them to make their decisions about opportunities that came their way in their social circle and at school. And they would come and say, Dad, I've been invited to do this. Is that okay? And we discussed what I thought would be what they should do and what, how they should respond, but I would leave it up to them. So you go pray about it, and you do what you think is right. Every time, they end up doing what I suggested. I didn't tell them they had to. I didn't punish them if they didn't. I didn't put a curfew on them. They loved me, and they knew I loved them. Well, when I see that dynamic with my own children, I'm reminded, God has the same love for me. And I should want to do what he wants because he loves me. I should want to serve him because I love him. I should want to follow the principles and the guidelines that he lays out in Scripture because of this fatherly love he has for me and the childlike love I have in return. I fall short constantly, but he never does. And my love can't reach up and touch him. His love is always holding me. And if that's true for me, it's true for every one of you in this room, even when you don't sense it, even when you see no evidence of it, even when you look deeply into your own heart and go, I'm not, there's no way he could love me. Because he has to know what's in him. He can't love me. The Bible says we love him because he first loved us. Well, there's a second son in this story. And it's the son who always obeys. It's a son who never left. It's a son who didn't get his inheritance. He just continued to serve. He comes and hears about the party, and he's upset. And he stands outside, and he's fuming. He probably said to a couple of servants, this is ridiculous. He's having a party for my brother, who went off and spent his entire inheritance in harlotry. I'm not going in there. The Bible says the father comes out and pleads. The honorable patriarch comes out to plead with the angry son who feels sorry. And he says to his son, it's only right. My son, your brother, who was dead, is alive. Let's eat and be merry. The father's love for you and I should be on the very forefront of our mind every single day. There are tough challenges coming in each one of our lives as individuals, but I think there are tough challenges coming to the Church of Jesus Christ. America is in a huge philosophical shift, a cultural shift, and it's not going to shift back. It's going to continue to go the way it's going. True believers in Jesus Christ and true believers of the Word of God are going to be a literal, true minority. With minority influence, with minority respect, even maybe the dismissal of complete insignificance in our culture. That is where we are headed, irrespective of the huge megachurches popping up all over. Our influence and our culture is diminishing by the day. How are we going to stand? Are we going to stand because the world now respects Christian men and women of character? Are we going to stand because our Father loves us? And he loves us when the world does not. He loves us when we can't give anything back. We have no money. He loves us when we are hungry. He loves us when we are disowned. And he loves us when we are persecuted. Will those days ever come? Only the Lord knows. But his love is what has sustained believers throughout Christian history. It hasn't been our affluence. It hasn't been our acceptance from the culture. It's been the Father's love. We see it here in the story of the prodigal son. The story is really about God and his extravagant love that never ceases and never weakens. It's always strong from the first day to the last. In John 17, when Jesus prayed, he prayed that God would make us one as he and the Father are one. And he prayed that we could be with him where he is. A love, a fellowship, and a longing to be with someone. My wife and I are going to experience that tug on our hearts tomorrow and for many, many months, maybe even years afterwards, as Dave and Bobby are a full country away. What made you kind of have gone through already, having your children move away? It's not anything to do. But for us, it will be a new challenge. Not be able to touch, see, and hear. See the bright eyes and the cheerful voice and the words of love from someone who loves so dearly.
but we have our Father, who loves us and holds us together. And if you came today and you're struggling in your faith, struggling with the meaning behind it, of the pertinence to it, what does it have to do with everyday life? It is the most important thing in our existence that our Creator loves us and sent His Son to die for us. That's who we are. Even if we're not very good at math, if we can't sing, if we can't play sports, if we're not really gifted in entrepreneurship, if we're whatever the list is, if you're just pretty much, you just take up space on the planet, God loves you. He sent His Son to die for you. That's who you are. And that picture of the Father running out to embrace His Son, you can almost imagine that same imagery when we die, as we go to heaven, and we are embraced by the Father. Your home is finally home. He loves you. I hope today that ministers to your heart, feeds your soul, and fuels you to live for Him the rest of this day. That's how I get it. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you that we can call you Father because of your grace and your mercy and the price that Christ paid on the cross to redeem us and reconcile us and reclaim us. And we are your children because you have given us rebirth. Lord, we thank you for that and we praise you for it. And I pray that even right now we will meditate on your love, what it means that you love us. Lord, it overshadows any other kind of love we can experience on earth. May we marvel in it. May we praise you for it. And Father, may your Spirit that's poured out into us, may we sense your love through him today. May you encourage every weary believer. May you reignite every extinguished flame of faith. May you comfort every broken heart. May you minister to each one of us as only you know that we have them. As this music softly plays, let me give you a moment of silence for you to pray right where you are seated, or if you want to come to the front to kneel at the altar, maybe you know somebody who needs to experience and know the love of God, and you want to pray for them. So take this time to focus on God's love for you, and may it enrich your soul. If you have never trusted in Christ as your Savior, I would encourage you to do that right now, right where you're seated. Receive the Father's love and offer to the sacrificial death of His Son, Jesus Christ. Trust in Him as your Lord. Confess Him as Savior. If you believe in your heart and confess Jesus as Lord, the Bible says you shall be saved. The gift is free to us, but it costs Him everything. Father, we love you with a fragile love, an inconsistent love, but a love that still is deep and is founded in your love for us. May we walk in your love today, and may we share it with others. May we truly love each other the way you love us. For we ask that in Jesus' name. Amen. Before we have just get to point, just a couple of brief announcements. First of all, tonight's stream team, fbcsarasota.com. You just go to the website, click on stream, and you can watch it live. It's about 15 minutes long usually. David is going to do it with me tonight as we talk about what does the love of God require. That's at 7. Wednesday night, we have Awana at 6:30, but a very special missionary guest, Bob Marshall, our missionary to Wales. I hope you'll be here with us tonight, Wednesday night at 6:30 to encourage Bob and family and hear from what their report is from Wales. The next 3 Sundays, we're having a new members class. If you'd like to consider joining the church or want to know more information about what that takes,
It'll be a 3-week class in my office, which is right through those doors, at 9:30 for the next 3 Sundays, and we'd like you to come to all 3. And then March 1st is the Awana Grand Prix. There's a table set up there underneath the clock. You can look at the cars and maybe buy your children their wood blocks so they can begin to build their cars. And a reminder that Rob Saint from Faith and Action will be with us sometime in the next couple of weeks. We'll let you know just as soon as we know. Before we leave, we're going to have a time to shake each other's hands and hear a song. I'd like to ask for Bobby and David to come up here to the front, if you would, just for a moment. I know David has been in the church here for 23 years, and Bobby since he was in, I forgot, what did he say, ninth grade? Since ninth grade. And it's just by God's providence or hand, he brought them together. Both of these two are a daily encouragement to me. And on Sundays, they're a real bright spot in my Sundays when I come into my office just to encourage and uplift me. And I'm going to miss them terribly. And my wife, the same, but in a different kind of way. We appreciate your prayers. But it's not about us. It's about these two sweet young people who are going off on it, following the prompting of God to go to Los Angeles and see what God would have for them there. I thought some of you might want to come down and be your goodbyes to them. So let me ask you all to please stand if you would. And we're going to have a time of shaking each other's hands. Feel free to move from your seats, come down here as our praise team closes off the service with a song. God bless you, and we'll see you Wednesday night.
Thank you.